Good evening. I hate to break up all of this really terrific conversation. We'll have an opportunity a little bit later when we have refreshments, and I hope you'll join us. My name is John Vinson. I'm the past master of Hudson Lodge, and I am among a group of people who have been here since 1876, who have led this lodge and led Freemasons in this area. You're sitting in a very historic lodge. This was actually founded by David Hudson, the founder of our town. In addition, there are a number of luminaries who are also members who are both with us today and, of course, who have gone to the Celestial Lodge above. In addition, we're a little bit infamous because John Brown, the abolitionist, once belonged to this lodge. And so you're sitting in a building steeped in history. Actually, this building is the former Hudson bus garage.
School bus garage.
It was also, I believe, a cheese factory or a cheese storage area. And now it houses the Freemasons. The Freemasons are a voluntary fraternity. And we are composed of men over the age of 19 who believe in brotherly love, relief, and truth. We want to reach out to the community, and that's one of the reasons that we're here tonight. We're so very pleased with the turnout that we've had. We have over 50 people here this evening who are here to honor our veterans, as well as to hear a very, very entertaining and informative program on the Battle of Midway, which was a pivotal battle in World War II. And I'd like to address this to the younger people in the audience. Do you realize that it wasn't a foregone conclusion that we were going to win World War II? Think about that for a second. In 1942, things were looking pretty darn grim. The Germans were on the move in Europe, gobbling up land. They started in the late 30s, and they had an aggressive policy for taking their neighbors. It would be like if Hudson decided to go to Stowe and annex it, and all of a sudden all of the rules in Stowe would apply, or all the rules in Hudson would apply to the rules in Stowe. The Japanese were doing the same thing in the Far East, very aggressive, and what they wanted to do, very simply, was to control the world. In 1942, It was not clear what was going to happen. And it's in that backdrop that we're going to hear about the Battle of Midway this evening. Our speaker is a very distinguished individual. Gordon Simon was inducted into the U.S. military in July of 1945 and was given his choice of naval service. He took his boot camp at the Great Lakes Naval Training Station. After boot camp, because of summer work experience in a machine shop and drafting courses he had taken in high school, he was made a fireman second class. He served aboard the APA 72 Clarendon, where he was promoted to fireman first class, and later served on the AKA 54 named the Algol. In 2000 and 2001, he worked part-time at the Military Air Preservation Society, which is just south of here in North Canton, at the Akron-Canton Airport. There, he was part of a team of people that actually restored a Dauntless dive bomber that was pulled from the bottom of Lake Michigan after 50 years. They restored it. It's now on static display on the carrier Midway in San Diego. Those are not his only accomplishments, though. Throughout his career, he has focused on information technology. And that is when information technology was really information technology. How many of you here remember punch cards? How many of you remember computers the size of this room? And that's the environment that Gordon operated in. And you can imagine the changes that he's seen over his career. He holds a bachelor's degree from Case Western Reserve University, and he's worked for such organizations as AM International, Cooper Energy, Automated Marketing Systems, and the Computer Task Group. He still remains active in community service activities. Among his many accomplishments, he and his wife Eileen have 4 children, 5 grandsons, and 3 granddaughters. And of course, Gordon is a member of our lodge, and we are blessed to have him as a member. So would you please help me welcome Gordon Simon.
Gotta get my notes, too much here to remember, so I hope you'll bear with me. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a story about heroes. There's one inanimate hero, the warplane that you see models of at the front of the room, and many, many human heroes that we'll be talking about. I saw a quote recently which I think fits this story very well. Lord Byron said, "But these are deeds which should not pass away, and names that must not wither." In order to fully understand the Battle of Midway, you have to go back to the Battle of the Coral Sea, which occurred about a month earlier in May 1942, and really even all the way back to Pearl Harbor. Here you see a map of the Pacific Theater in 1941 and 1942. Here you can see Oahu and Pearl Harbor, and Midway is at this point. You notice that the Coral Sea runs along the northeast border of Australia. The thing I'd like to impress upon you is the size of the Pacific Ocean. You don't get a good feeling for it here, but the Pacific Ocean is a very huge place, very large place. You know, 70% of the Earth's surface is covered with water, and the Pacific Ocean is a pretty good chunk of it. To give you some idea, the distance between Pearl Harbor and Midway is 1,135 miles. And when Japan attacked Pearl Harbor, they had to travel 3,400 miles to do it. So you can get an appreciation for how big the Pacific Ocean really is. I wanted to talk first about some of the Japanese aircraft we'll be talking about this evening. You can read the legends under the pictures. The Kate is described as the best torpedo bomber in the world at that time. And the Betty is a two-engine bomber. Probably shouldn't be on this particular screen because it was not involved at Midway. The Betty was a land-based bomber which was used against ships, but only if they were within range of an airfield. You've probably all heard of the Zero, which was the best dogfighter in the world at the time. The reason I wanted to show all 4 of these aircraft is that first, they were all used throughout the war by Japan, and secondly, they all shared the same shortcomings. None of them had armor protection for the pilot or the crew, and none of them had self-sealing fuel tanks, as the American planes did. So if you got a good burst into them, you'd either kill the crew, the plane would explode or catch on fire, or all 3. The Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor with a very large armada, and the attack was a tactical success, but a strategic error. Here's a diagram of the anchorage at Pearl Harbor on the morning of December 7, 1941. This area here was called Battleship Row, and if there had been aircraft carriers at Pearl Harbor that morning, they would have been anchored in that area. But the point here is there were no aircraft carriers at Pearl Harbor on December 7th. The mistake the Japanese made was they did not attack the powerhouse, the repair facilities, or especially the oil tank farms. You can see all of these oil tank farms. The tanks were all above ground and filled to capacity. After the attack, the Japanese combined fleet in Tokyo said the following: Upon reexamination of the damage report, it was not so favorable as had first been supposed. This was largely because Nagumo's force had not located the U.S. carriers. By failing to exploit the shock, bewilderment, and confusion on Oahu, by failing to take full advantage of its attack against Admiral Kimmel's ships, by failing to pulverize the Pearl Harbor base, by failing to destroy Oahu's vast fuel stores, and by failing to seek out and destroy America's carriers, Japan committed his first and probably his greatest strategical error of the entire Pacific War. Here's an artist's representation of Admiral Nimitz arriving at Pearl Harbor on Christmas Day, 1941. He was sent to Pearl Harbor to relieve Admiral Kimmel, who had been relieved of his duties. Now let's talk about the Coral Sea Battle. To isolate Australia and draw the American fleet into battle, the Japanese commanders established a three-prong operation. First, occupy Tulagi. Follow this with a landing at Port Moresby. Port Moresby is over here. In order to bring Northern Australia into range of Japanese aircraft. As I said earlier, here's Australia. Getting Port Moresby would mean they'd be able, the Japanese would be able to attack Australia. Second, carry out an overwhelming attack on Midway to trigger a decisive naval battle. And third, once these two operations are complete, the Japanese will overrun the Fiji and Samoan Islands in order to cut off the lifeline from the United States. American scout planes spotted the Japanese strike force, including two large carriers, the Shokaku and the Zukaku, and one light carrier, Shoho, and notified Pearl Harbor. Admiral Nimitz expected the Yorktown with Admiral Fletcher and Lexington with Admiral Fitch, with their approximately 150 aircraft, to be able to halt the Japanese advance. Fletcher and Fitch rendezvoused in the Coral Sea on May 1, 1942, the same day the Australians evacuated Tulagi. Admiral Halsey arrived at Pearl Harbor on May 26 with Enterprise and Hornet after having taken Doolittle and his B-25s to the Tokyo air raid, and he was too late to take part in the Coral Sea. Now we'll look at some of the U.S. aircraft we're going to be talking about. These are carrier-based aircraft. After the Battle of Midway, these planes were described as totally unsuited for modern warfare. They were slow, they were clumsy, they were easy prey for the Zeros. Now the Dauntless on the left, you see, is the plane that won the Battle of Midway. I probably should change that picture because those white bars were added later to the star, so those aren't quite the colors at Midway. And the Wildcat was the fighter at that time. Initially had a tough time against Zeros, but eventually they developed some tactics that made them pretty successful. The Japanese landed at Tulagi on May 3rd, and the Japanese carriers were well into the Coral Sea by May 6th. The U.S. destroyer Sims and the oiler Neosho were sunk by Japanese bombers. Lexington SBDs and torpedo bombers spotted and attacked the light carrier Shoho on May 7. She was hit by two 1,000-pound bombs and other bombs and was completely on fire. The ship was abandoned at 11:31 and sank 5 minutes later. The Port Moresby landing by the Japanese was called off. And this might be a good time to talk about the colors and the markings on these aircraft. At Coral Sea, you can see there were red stripes on the vertical stabilizer and a red dot, they called the meatball, in the middle of the star. When they were returning to their carriers, their own anti-aircraft gunners tried to shoot them down. So what happened was they took all of the red paint, they painted over the red paint, enlarged the stars on the side of the fuselage and on the wings. And so at Midway, plane's colors and markings were the same as this model here. The other model has the Coral Sea markings on it. On May 8th, the Yorktown launched 39 planes at 0915, which spotted and attacked the carrier Shokaku and Zukaku. Those were two of Japan's newest carriers, and they had taken part in the attack on Pearl Harbor. Both carriers were heavily damaged. At 11:18, Japanese bombers attacked the Lexington and Yorktown. The Lexington was hit by torpedoes and dive bombers, and the Yorktown was hit by an 800-pound bomb. The Lexington, which had been listing at 7 degrees, was put back on an even keel, but a series of internal explosions caused massive fires. The ship stopped at 16:30 and was abandoned at 17:07. So you can see here, that's not a real good picture, that's an actual photograph. The men going over the side, you can just barely see a destroyer that pulled alongside to help get the survivors off. The abandonment of the Lexington was so disciplined and orderly, not a single crew member was lost. Even the captain's dog was saved. The destroyer Phelps fired torpedoes into the Lex and she sank at 20:00. That's 8 p.m. Admiral Nimitz ordered the fleet to retire from the Coral Sea. He knew the Battle of Midway was coming up, the Port Moresby invasion had been thwarted, and the enemy had retired. So what was the significance of the Coral Sea battle, and how did it impact the Battle of Midway? The capture of Port Moresby had been prevented, the threat against Australia had been eliminated, and the carriers Shokaku and Zukaku had been put out of service for a long time, and they might have made the difference at Midway. Furthermore, the Japanese thought the Yorktown had been sunk, and they were surprised at Midway. I mentioned that Admiral Nimitz knew the Midway was coming. Naval cryptographers at Pearl Harbor and Washington had been working for some time to break the Japanese code they called JN-25. Not long before December 1941, they believed they had broken significant parts of it. JN-25 consisted of 45,000 five-digit numbers which designated various words and phrases. It was extremely difficult to break for two reasons. First, the Japanese code books containing the designations were changed from time to time. Secondly, messages would often include meaningless portions specifically to frustrate anybody trying to decrypt it. Admiral Nimitz was reluctant at first to believe his cryptographers and to act on their recommendations because he felt the Japanese might be giving us false information, intentionally giving us false information. Commander Joseph Rochefort, chief of the combat intelligence officer at Pearl Harbor, came up with a plan. He had been intercepting coded Japanese messages which talked about operations, in other words, attacks, at AF. He believed that AF meant Midway. He had Midway send a message to Pearl Harbor in the clear, saying that they were experiencing freshwater problems because one of their condensers had broken down. Within 48 hours, they intercepted a Japanese message saying that AF was having freshwater problems. So this pretty much convinced Nimitz. And even before the Battle of Midway, he knew the name of the officer the Japanese had selected to govern Midway after the invasion. Now here's the Midway Atoll. It's approximately 6 miles in diameter. Consists of two islands, Sand Island to the left and Eastern Island on the right. You notice that the airstrips are on Eastern Island. Now here's a diagram of the battle itself, the battle area. And the things I'd like to point out are, first of all, on the night of June 3rd, a weather front came into that area, which caused all kinds of reconnaissance and observation problems for both sides. The Japanese armada for the Midway Aleutian operation was the largest in history. The Japanese fleet consisted of 115 surface ships versus 30 ships in the American fleet. Admiral Yamamoto himself, the architect of the Midway Aleutian Plan, flew his flag from the newest and largest Japanese battleship, the Yamato. Admiral Nagumo led the strike force with four carriers. Admiral Nagumo was on the carrier Akagi, leading the strike force. The purpose of the Aleutian thrust was twofold. First, to lure any American ships in the area out from around the Midway area and sink them. And secondly, to land troops in the Aleutian Islands, and they did in fact land troops on Attu and Kiska. Down here you can see other ships coming from Saipan, troop ships carrying 10,000 troops and minesweepers. Admiral Fletcher limped into Pearl Harbor on the Yorktown at 14:30 on May 27. Admiral Nimitz had the superintendent of the Navy shipyard come aboard the Yorktown, survey the damage, and give him an estimate for how long it would take to repair the Yorktown. The superintendent said 90 days. And Admiral Nimitz said, "You have 4 days." The Yorktown was put into dry dock, the crew removed, and more than 1,400 workmen poured in, over, and under the ship, working in shifts 24 hours a day. At 1100 on May 29, the dock was flooded, and the Yorktown moved into the stream with hundreds of workers still aboard. She fueled, took on replacement planes, and sailed out of Pearl at 0900 on May 30, less than 3 days after she'd arrived. Her new air group, a composite from three different carriers, worked together the first time at Midway. Initially, Admiral Halsey was supposed to take Yorktown to Midway, but before the ship left Pearl Harbor, Halsey became very ill with shingles. He was first treated at the hospital at Pearl, but was later flown to the United States and put into the hospital in the States. Admiral Nimitz formed two task forces. Task Force 16, Admiral Spruance with the Enterprise and Hornet, and Task Force 17 with Admiral Fletcher on Yorktown with tactical command of the entire operation. This was Admiral Spruce's first command of an aircraft carrier. Prior to that, all of his experience had been in cruisers. The carriers moved to a position northeast of Midway. We'll go back to that slide in a minute. To wait there to intercept the Japanese armada. The rendezvous point was called Point Luck. The U.S. also stationed 11 submarines around Midway and four north of Pearl Harbor. Now here were some of the land aircraft that we'll be talking about in a minute. The B-26, twin-engine bomber, very difficult airplane to fly. It was a real widow maker initially. One of the reasons was the wings were very short. They called it the flying prostitute because it had no means of support. One of the men I worked with at MAPS not only flew B-26s, he was a B-26 instructor. This is a B-17E. Oh, I didn't want to do that. This is a B-17E. We have a B-17 pilot, I think, in the audience someplace. He knows more about B-17s than I do, but this one you'll notice does not have the chin turret under the nose, which was added, I think, with the G model, the B-17G, when German fighter pilots discovered the best way to attack a B-17 is head-on at 12 o'clock. Uh, The Buffalo was a fighter based on Midway, and it was called an unmitigated disaster. It was slow, it was clumsy, it was easy prey for Zeros, and was never used again in combat after Midway. The PBY was a very important plane at Midway for two reasons: reconnaissance, observation. It had a range of 2,000 miles, and for picking up airmen who would have to ditch. The PBY could land in the water and pick them up. And we have a PBY pilot in the audience someplace. Charlie, where's Charlie? I don't know whether to believe him, but Charlie told me he spent World War II flying a PBY looking for German submarines in the Gulf of Mexico. Is that right, Charlie? I guess it's true. First sighting of the Japanese fleet was made by a PBY 700 miles from Midway, down here. 9 B-17s from Midway were sent out and dropped a number of bombs at 570 miles from Midway without a single hit. At this point, the U.S. carriers were 200 miles northwest of Midway, somewhere in this area, when Enterprise received a message from a reconnaissance plane at 0534 on June 4 of enemy carriers. Fletcher ordered Spruance with Enterprise and Hornet proceed southwesterly and attack enemy carriers when definitely located. Meanwhile, 20 Buffaloes and 6 old Wildcats defending Midway were completely outclassed by Zeke fighters. 17 were shot down and 7 were severely damaged. Six new TBF Avengers and 4 Army B-26s with torpedoes left Midway at 0615 without fighter escort to attack the Japanese fleet. Out of the 6 TBFs, only 1 returned, badly shot up. There were no torpedo hits. Admiral Nagumo on Akagi was now rearming 93 planes from torpedoes to bombs for a second attack on Midway. His pilots coming back after the first wave said a second attack was needed. When he heard reports of enemy ships, he changed his mind and ordered that torpedoes not already removed should be left on the planes. 16 Marine Corps SBDs from Midway attacked the enemy ships. 8 returned, 6 damaged beyond repair. Lieutenant Iverson had his throat microphone shot off, and when he managed to crash land on Sand Island, the mechanics counted 219 holes in his plane. That's Lieutenant Iverson's SBD. And if you see a better photograph, you can see where the stripes on the tail had been painted over. Yep. And the stars enlarged. 15 B-17s from Midway dropped 8,500 pounds per plane from 20,000 feet with no hits. In summary, there was no damage and few casualties inflicted by land-based planes on June 4. The Japanese were still steaming for Midway. 4 carriers in a box: flagship Akagi, Kaga astern, Hiryu and Soryu to port, to the left. Commander Ring's 35 SBDs with fighter escort missed the expected rendezvous point, followed a course back to Midway, and missed the battle. Lieutenant Commander Waldron, leading Hornet's top torpedo squadron, knew he had little chance to survive. He was encountering very heavy anti-aircraft fire and had no fighter cover. Out of 30 pilots and crewmen, only 1 man survived. An Enterprise torpedo squadron launched at 0806 with no fighter protection. 10 of 14 were shot down, no torpedo hits. Yorktown's torpedo squadron came in at 1,000. The Wildcats were overwhelmed by Zeke's, and 7 Devastators were shot down. 5 of those had launched torpedoes, and then 3 of those were shot down. No hits. In summary, out of 42 torpedo planes from 3 carriers, only 6 returned and not a single torpedo had hit a target. But this is what the torpedo bombers accomplished. They caused frantic maneuvering by the Japanese ships and tied up the Zeeks so the SBDs were almost unopposed and dropped bombs on full deck loads of planes being refueled and rearmed. In effect, the Japanese carriers were floating arsenals. Here you see some SBDs starting their dives into the fleet, and you can see down here where the Japanese ships are taking evasive action. Lieutenant Commander McCluskey launched with 37 SBDs loaded with 500 and 1,000-pound bombs at 0745. Akagi was hit and was on fire. There were fires on Soryu and Kaga, which was hit by four bombs. Lieutenant Commander Leslie's squadron of 17 SBDs from Yorktown struck Soryu in three waves, scoring three hits with 1,000-pound bombs. Now, some of the following exhibits were done by Robert Grant Smith, who's considered one of the best naval aviation artists of all time. There aren't a whole lot of photographs, actual photographs of Midway. There are a few, but of course they're all in black and white, and some of them are kind of fuzzy. But these are beautiful representations by Robert Grant Smith. Now this is Lieutenant Ware's division, which was VS-6, attacking the carrier Kaga. And I'm going to tell you more about Lieutenant Ware and VS-6 in a moment. Here's another painting which was called The Turning Point. Now you might recognize this. This is the picture I chose for my opening slide. VS-6 has just successfully attacked the carrier Akagi, and Lieutenant Ware is leading them home. The SBD in the background, which was S-5, has run out of fuel due to battle damage and is about to ditch. The two crewmen were later picked up by the Japanese destroyer Makagumo, interrogated, tortured, and executed. The SBDs are formed up to repel an attack by six Zeros from the Hiryu, who are on their way to attack the Yorktown. Not only did the Zeros fail to knock down a single SBD, two of the Zeros had to return to the Hiryu due to battle damage. The fighting had cost VS-6 valuable fuel, which they would need to get back home. Only one aircraft, S-15, ever found its way back, ditching near the U.S. fleet. Lieutenant Ware had successfully led his men through fighter attacks after the bombing of the Kaga, only to perish with the others in the vast expanse of the Pacific Ocean. Lieutenant Ware was awarded the Navy Cross posthumously, and later in the war, the new destroyer, DD-865, was named the USS Charles R. Ware. Meanwhile, valves from the Hiryu, which had become separated from the other Japanese carriers, were attacking Yorktown. Wildcat shot down 10, but 8 got through, scoring 3 hits. Hiryu's second wave came in, and at 1442, two torpedoes hit. The order to abandon ship was given at 1500, that's 3 p.m., and four destroyers came alongside to pick up survivors. 10 SBDs from Yorktown, returning from a three-hour search mission, spotted Hiryu. At 1530, Enterprise launched 24 SBDs, and they attacked the Hiryu at 1700. They scored four direct hits, and the Hiryu was on fire. Aboard the Hiryu, Admiral Yamamoto ordered the Hiryu torpedoed. Captain Kaku, who was the captain of the Hiryu, and Admiral Namaguchi, who was aboard, refused to leave the ship. They drank a farewell toast from a water cask and were given ceremonial sashes with which they lashed themselves to the bridge. The rest of the crew was removed, and at 5:10, the destroyer Makagumo fired two torpedoes at the Hiryu. One missed, the other exploded, and the Hiryu finally went down at 0900, carrying her admiral and captain to the depths of the Pacific. On June 5th, a PBY spotted the heavy cruisers Mogami and Makumo. Six SBDs and six Vindicators found the cruisers and attacked at 0805. They encountered heavy anti-aircraft fire and had six near misses, but Marine Captain Fleming crashed his SBD-2 into an after turret of the Makumo. Early on June 6th, a reconnaissance flight saw the two damaged cruisers. At 0800, 26 SBDs and 8 4Fs left Hornet, 31 SBDs, 3 TBDs, and 12 F4Fs from Enterprise followed at 1045. 24 SBDs and 8 F4Fs from Hornet launched at 1330. Mogami got away to truck for repairs, but was out of service for a year. Makumo was abandoned. The destroyer Arashio picked up survivors, but an SBD dropped a bomb on the deck, killing most survivors. Another bomb detonated the Makuma's torpedoes, and she went down. At 0255 on June 7th, Admiral Yamamoto ordered a general retirement. He'd lost a heavy cruiser, all four of his fleet carriers, and over 300 planes. A particularly bitter loss was the Akagi, the flagship, the queen of flat tops, and the symbol of Japanese naval air power. When Admiral Yamamoto ordered the Akagi torpedoed, the captain of the Akagi wept and said, "We cannot sink one of the Emperor's warships with his own torpedoes." Yamamoto replied, "Remember that I was once the captain of the Akagi. I will apologize to the Emperor." A destroyer pulled alongside the Akagi, fired torpedoes into her, and she went down. Admiral Spruance withdrew Enterprise and Hornet to the east. First, he did not want to risk a night encounter with a much superior force. He knew the Japanese were very skilled at night engagements. Night operations from a carrier are extremely difficult and hazardous. Secondly, he wanted to be closer to Midway in order to attack retreating forces or break up a landing attack on Midway. Admiral Spruance was criticized after the battle for this decision, but it was exactly the right one. When he signaled Admiral Fletcher, giving him his recommendation and asking for orders, Admiral Fletcher replied simply, "I will follow your movements." Meanwhile, the Yorktown was still afloat. The 2,270 survivors were aboard the seven destroyers of the screen. It was decided that the Yorktown could be saved. The destroyer Hammond pulled along the starboard side to put a salvage party aboard and to provide power, pumps, and water for their work. In the early afternoon of June 6, the Japanese submarine I-168 found the Yorktown, somehow got through the screen, and at 1330 fired four torpedoes. One missed, one went under the Hammond's keel, two went under the Hammond's keel and hit the Yorktown, and the fourth hit Hammond amidships, breaking her in half. She sank in 4 minutes with great loss of life. There were tremendous underwater explosions as the Hammond reached the depth at which all of its depth charges had been set, and they detonated. The Yorktown's list continued to increase. On June 7th, the escorting destroyers half-masted their colors. All hands came to attention, uncovered, that is, took their caps off. At 0600, the Yorktown rolled over and sank in 3,000 fathoms. That's 18,000 feet, or almost 3 miles of water. By the afternoon of June 7, Yamamoto had given up. He spent much of June 8th fueling and heading for home. Midway was the first smashing defeat inflicted on the Japanese Navy in modern times. It was the second of five great battles in the Pacific, in which aircraft did all the hitting without a shot from ship's gunfire except anti-aircraft fire. Midway marked the end of the battleship as the most feared ship in naval warfare. The aircraft carrier was now queen of the seas. If the Japanese had any doubt about the courage and determination of American fighting men before the Battle of Midway, they didn't have it, excuse me, they didn't have any after the battle. Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 4 begin as follows. And there were giants in the earth. The American fighting personnel who fought and died at Midway truly were giants in the earth. And so the war with Japan that began at Pearl Harbor ended on September 2, 1945, on the deck of the battleship Missouri, anchored in Tokyo Bay, where the Japanese signed an unconditional surrender document. General LeMay's B-29s had burned 66 Japanese cities to the ground. Atomic bombs had been dropped on two Japanese cities, and the firebombing of Tokyo had resulted in more casualties than at either Hiroshima or Nagasaki. This is General Jonathan Wainwright. He had surrendered to the Japanese on Corregidor with 3,500 troops in May 1942 and had been held in Japanese prison camps on Luzon, Formosa, and Manchuria until liberated by Russian troops in August 1945. He received the Congressional Medal of Honor. Admiral Nimitz was one of the Americans who signed the surrender document. Admiral Nimitz was one of only four five-star admirals in U.S. history. And presiding over the ceremony was General Douglas MacArthur. General MacArthur was one of only four five-star generals in U.S. history. He presided over the ceremony. After the surrender, he governed Japan from August 1945 until April 1952. I remember hearing a radio broadcast of the ceremony and hearing General MacArthur end the ceremony by saying, "These proceedings are closed," and the Japanese representatives left the Missouri. Thanks for your attention. Do you have any questions? Maybe we could turn the lights up, John. Any questions either on the battle or these warplanes? I'll try to answer them. Yes?
In the European earlier part of the war, submarines played a very important part in the advantage. Was there much submarine activity in the Pacific?
There was some, but there was none that I know of at Midway. As I said earlier, there were 11 submarines based around Midway, American submarines, and four around Pearl Harbor. But I don't know of any actual submarine action other than the one that sunk the Yorktown.
I hate to miss this stuff.
Gordon, you mentioned the bombs were kind of unique that they used.
Well, yes, they were delayed action bombs. The decks of the Japanese aircraft carriers were wood. And so these bombs would hit, go through the deck, go through the flight deck, and explode inside the ship. It was just a second or two delay. But hopefully you'd hit some oil tanks, gasoline tanks, or ammunition, torpedoes. The way they did that, when the SBDs were lined up on the carriers to launch, the ones closest to the front of the ship were loaded with 500-pound bombs because they had a shorter length of deck to take off, and the SBDs further aft would be loaded with the 1,000-pound bombs. And, of course, they had more room to take off. Yes?
Do you have any idea of the total loss of life on both sides, Battle of Midway?
I probably have seen those numbers, but I don't really remember right now. I might say that when we talked about the Japanese losses, one of the biggest losses to Japan was the loss of those air crews, because those were the most experienced pilots. They'd all taken part in the attack on Pearl Harbor, the most experienced pilots they had, and they lost most of those aircrews. After Midway, Japan shortened the length of training for their naval pilots by 2/3, from 9 months to 3 months. And it showed. The caliber of their pilots really dropped dramatically after Midway.
What percentage would you say was, did those numbers represent, as far as either loss of the Japanese airline?
Well, let me get at that another way. 2 years later, in June of 1944, was the Battle of the Philippine Sea. And that battle was so one-sided in favor of the United States, it was called the Marianas Turkey Shoot. Japan lost another 300 to 350 aircraft in that battle. And that pretty much broke their back. They lost all those aircraft and all those air crews. So I'd say, at Midway, they probably lost 25 or 30% of their air crews. And at the Battle of the Philippine Sea, they lost another third. So that kind of pretty much broke their back.
Questions? You say Midway is kind of the turning point at the war. I was under the impression that after Midway, with Yorktown being sunk, the only aircraft carrier we had left at that time was probably that was fully functional, was Enterprise. And the Japanese still had a pretty sizable fleet. I mean, were we still in a precarious position?
Well, yes, let me get at that a different way either. At the time of Pearl Harbor, the United States had 7 aircraft carriers. I'm not even counting. CV-1 was the Langley, which was the first aircraft carrier that the United States ever built. But CV-2 was the Lexington, and these were their hull numbers. So we lost the Lexington at the Coral Sea. We lost the Yorktown at Midway. That left us with 5. 2 years later, this is a good indication of the industrial might of this country. 2 years later, Japan went into the Battle of the Philippine Sea with 9 aircraft carriers, and we went into the battle with 15. What they did was, the United States had a number of ships under construction, battleships and cruisers, for example. They were converted in mid-construction to aircraft carriers. And by 2 years after Midway, we had 50. No, some of them were escort carriers called CVEs, which originally were meant just to ferry new aircraft back and forth to the fleet. But it turns out that in some of the later battles in the Pacific, escort carriers were used. But they were smaller. But that's amazing. The Battle of the Philippine Sea, the United States launched 250 aircraft in 15 minutes. And Japan lost 300 to 350 against our loss of 15 or 20, and 6 of those were by accident.
A lot of the issue there was because we had self-sealing gas tanks and the jet. Why didn't Japan ever spend more in terms of the armament of the aircraft or self-sealing tanks like we did? Was there any rationale?
Well, I think the reasons were twofold, maybe. One was they might not have had the steel. They might have been allocating their steel to other things, like aircraft carriers. Also, that made their planes lighter. That's one reason the Zero was so maneuverable. It was very light. It lost a lot of its maneuverability at higher speeds, but at lower speeds for dogfighting and so forth, it was very light. We captured a Zero fairly intact early in the war, shipped it back to the United States, and aeronautical engineers went over it, and they probably took it apart bolt by bolt, put it back together. They put a coat of paint on it, it slowed the Zero down 20 miles an hour. So, you know. So one of the ways that a Wildcat, for example, if a Wildcat dove away from a Zero, it would lose a lot of its maneuverability at higher speeds. Then they also developed another tactic where they flew in twos. They had wingmen, and they would watch each other's tail. There was a Commander Thatch that worked out this technique, so it became known as the Thatch Weave. So in the end, the Wildcat had a favorable kill ratio, and when the F6F came out, the Hellcat, the ratio was 8 or 9 or 10 to 1. Yes?
You had mentioned the U.S. torpedo attacks against the Japanese fleet in Midway, and you said that there were no hits. Were they, at that point in time, were they still using the faulty torpedoes?
Yes. The three reasons why those torpedo attacks were unsuccessful. One was inadequate training of our pilots, torpedo pilots. Ensign Gay took off with a torpedo under his plane for the very first time from a carrier. He'd never even taken off an airplane with a torpedo in it from dry land or, you know, in training. And what's more, he said he had never seen it done. The second reason was the aircraft themselves were slow and easy target for anti-aircraft gunners and the Zeros. And probably the worst single problem was that torpedo. It was the Mark 13, and it just was practically useless. It was almost useless.
Was it ever identified why they were faulty?
I'm not sure, and the naval authorities in Washington kept denying that there was a problem for a while. But the torpedo was too slow, so it gave ships time to maneuver away from it. Occasionally it would porpoise. It would break the surface of the water, go off course, and then when its fuel ran out, sink. But eventually it was replaced and with a better torpedo. But that was the Mark 13. It was useless.
They changed the firing pin into an aluminum firing pin. It worked pretty good after that.
Jim, I didn't hear you.
They on that Mark 13, they changed the firing pin from steel to aluminum, and it worked after that.
Oh, I didn't know that. It's good to know. Yes?
In all of your slides, were there any original photographs in them slides? Or that, or
yes,
are they
yes, there were,
artists,
there were a few.
Renderings?
There were a few.
I thought so. That's what I was thinking.
The one
in particular, the one that showed that we were trying to knock out two Japanese ships.
Yeah, the two cruisers.
The one in the middle. Was that taken aerial wise?
Yeah, that was a photograph, I think. And there's one, if you do research in Midway, there's a lot of material on the internet. You come across the one photograph I had quite often, and that's the one where they were diving, I think, at the Coral Sea to attack the Shoho. I see that picture a lot when I... the photograph of the Yorktown was a photograph, of course, the Yorktown sinking and the Yorktown in dry dock. And there were a few others. Lieutenant Iverson's SBD was a photograph. But a lot of those, as I say, were artists' representations and beautiful paintings. Yes?
You mentioned about the Aleutian Islands. What was that combined that figure under the Battle of Midway?
Well, they did land troops up there, and I'm not sure how long they stayed. But, you know, we had some operations in the Aleutians, too, during the war. And eventually...
Was that the purpose?
Excuse me?
Was it just a decoy with the invasion?
No, they intended to leave them there, to form bases up there, and I'm not sure how long they were there. Eventually, I think Japan came and evacuated them, took them back home. Yes? Yes?
Yeah, like the gentleman mentioned, I was wondering about the significance of the Aleutians, unless you're an ice fisherman or something like that. Were they going to, like jump off towards the west coast, you know?
Well, I don't know if that was the eventual plan.
What was the country doing at that time?
I know this, if you were in the American military, that was terrible duty up there. That was terrible duty. Yes.
Naval history points out that the Japanese attacked Alaska so they could split the Pacific Fleet and draw part of it up there to eliminate or give them a hard time on their invasion of Alaska. But it tied in with the attack on Midway.
Was we making preparations on the West Coast? Did we realize the importance?
Well, we had operations up there. We had troops up there for a period of time.
Yeah, we had some battle. We went after them up there. We actually attacked them and ran off.
Yeah. And speaking about bad duty, I talked to some fellow seamen when I was in the Navy, and if you were an American sailor in Australia at about this time, around the time of the Coral Sea Battle, you could have pretty much anything you wanted, and you couldn't spend any money. That was pretty good duty, but...
Gordon, you have a question from the center?
Yes.
Oh, it's more of a comment. My father was on the USS Pensacola CA-24. He did duty out in the Aleutians prior to the bombing of Nagasaki and Hiroshima. The Alaskan Highway was built during World War II by U.S. troops, knowing that the Japanese had a land base there, and they were trying to spread out down to Alaska. After we built the Alaskan Highway, they sent small destroyers. That's the USS Pensacola was a small destroyer, and they were up in the Aleutian Islands to dispatch any Japanese fleet that was traveling in that area. Then they, after that was dispatched, he did not find out. All he knew was that one day they all started to sail south, the entire U.S. fleet. Everybody was in the Aleutians, everybody was up in that area. They were going south. They found out later, the idea was, if those bombs don't work, every ship in the fleet was to blow the nation of Japan off the earth. They were sending everyone down south, but it did work. The bombs were successful.
Any other questions? Yes.
Not a question, but I wonder if you would ask the veterans of the Second World War to stand so that we could applaud them?
Oh, yes. It's a good idea.
Before we do that, I would like to add, and I don't know how you want to do it, but I think we should take a moment of silence for those that did not come back, lost their lives, and are laying out at the bottom of the Pacific Ocean right now.
Stand.
Would everyone care to stand, and we will have that moment of silence. Thank you. Would those World War II veterans remain standing?
John, I would like to express my appreciation. I joined the fleet right after Midway and was in Alaska and then went down to Guadalcanal, and then worked my way up to Okinawa, and I came home just before Okinawa. But I would like to, on the behalf of all those of us who were present during those years, express our appreciation for you for this wonderful turnout this evening. It's really heartwarming.
Ladies and gentlemen, may we have a very hearty round of applause for our speaker this evening. You know, it really is astounding when you think about the knowledge that we have with us, as well as the knowledge and experience that we have in this room this evening. One of the things I am remiss on, and I do apologize, is I would like everyone to stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, we would like to re-welcome everyone, anyone who came in a little later. We are really, really very blessed with a number of community members.
veterans and their families, as well as my fellow Masons. I'd also like to thank you, Gordon, for your excellent presentation. It is just astounding when you think about the fact that all of this happened well over 60 years ago. And yet, the themes resonate, don't they? Courage, sacrifice, hard work. You know, people really learning as they go. I've spent most of my adult life teaching people. And one of the neat things about it is when people are put into situations and it looks like it's hopeless, they learn how to perhaps figure out a way out. And it's always energizing to hear that people throughout history have done this. I'd also like to thank our lodge, and that's our master, William of Blay, who is unable to be here due to work requirements. We'd also like to take a moment to thank people who are in our safety forces. Our master, Bill, is a Bainbridge police officer, and he joins with his counterparts all over the country in terms of both police and fire. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank him and his associates for everything they do to help us to maintain a safe society. I would also like to thank our Grand Master, Most Worshipful Brother Ronald L. Winnett. Now, it's kind of interesting. In Masonry, there's no one super organization that makes decisions for Masons. Every state has a Grand Lodge. And every year, a new person becomes the Grand Master. And in this case, it's Ronald L. Winnett. And this is a very special time for us as Masons. This is our 200th anniversary in Ohio. We began in 1808, and with six lodges down near Chillicothe who got together and said, you know what, we think that we should make this a little more formal. And so we are the recipients of their foresight and their vision. You know, I unfortunately did not serve my country in a military capacity. My father did. As I was thinking about this, Mom, do you remember when we used to play Army? Soldiers, sailors, pilots were our heroes because we knew what they had done for us. Remember, I started off by saying that it wasn't a foregone conclusion that we were going to win this war. Well, the good news is we did. And we have a number of people in this room to thank. And of course, all the people that they represent who are not here. All over the nation this weekend, Americans are gathering together to remember and pay tribute to our veterans. Today is a chance to thank those who have selflessly answered the call to duty and to remember those who have served. I would like to once again ask any member of the military, please stand so we can recognize you. Seated. Now, I'd also like to invite any family members of the people who are here who are in the military to stand so that we may recognize you. Please. Speaking on behalf of the citizens of the land that you have protected and defended, I am proud to recognize all of you. Any morning we wake up in a free land, it is due to the fact that there is a person who has defended this country and helped us to remain free. We are honored by all of the veterans here this evening. We're honored by the family members, and we're honored by the community members. We're especially honored by your presentation this evening, Gordon. You know, it's interesting. I was doing a little bit of research, and according to the U.S. Census, prior to 9/11, there were 26 million veterans in this country, 30% of whom are disabled. I mean, think about that. Would you be willing to give up some capacity that you have in order that we could have this meeting in a free and open society? That's really where it comes down to for me. And for 230 years, the men and women of America's armed forces have answered the nation's call to duty. You know, it's interesting. We've seen veterans who began at the Battle for Independence, and then they moved through numerous battles over the years. They have crouched in muddy trenches in Europe, confronted the enemy from the rocky crags of the Italian Alps, and struggled up the sandy beaches of Normandy. They froze through the bitter winters in South Korea and steamed in the sodden jungles of Vietnam. And now they're chasing terrorists throughout the mountainous regions of Afghanistan and trying to bring peace to Iraq. But this is not all our soldiers have done. Even beyond fighting in wars, our troops have engaged in humanitarian missions and peacekeeping missions. I like to think that anyone who's ever been in the U.S. military has always been part of the good guys. You know, and I remember when I was young, soldiers protected students when they tried to desegregate schools. I mean, it was soldiers who oftentimes guaranteed that they could walk in without fear. Our soldiers are helping to get food and shelter to millions of people left homeless by earthquakes in Pakistan. They're working right here in America getting food to people who are affected by hurricanes. Down in New Orleans. The mission and theater of operation may change, but throughout the world, soldiers are still the ones who answer the call to duty when there's a job to do. And I would like you, as we go through the weekend, just to step back and reflect on the contributions of all of those soldiers, past, present, and those soldiers who will serve in the future. We appreciate the fact that you have come here to share this evening with us, and we hope that God will bless you and also all the veterans who serve around the world. And of course, God bless the United States of America, where, because of our soldiers today, the veteran soldiers of yesterday, is still the land of the free, the home of the brave. We have refreshments, if you care to partake. But before we do that, we have a couple of things that we'd like to give away. Now, being Masons, we are not allowed to engage in anything that resembles gambling. We simply can't do it. Even a raffle, any game of chance, it is not in our code. Brotherly Love, Relief, and Truth, we go out there and we try to give people something because we have gotten the same in return. And so if you would look inside your program, if inside your program there is a small either red or blue star, who has the red star? You have the red star, Bob? Would you like to come forward, please? We have a small token of the evening. Bob, we have for you this model that was personally chosen by Gordon, and it is a replica of the Dauntless SBD dive bomber.
Great. Well, thank you very much, John.
We understand. Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you for a fine presentation. That's very, very interesting tonight.
Okay. And who has the other star? Must have gotten lost. Well, we will try to find an owner before the evening is out for this model. This is most graciously donated by our past master, Richard Amlin. And this is an actual model. What would you say the year on this was, Rich, approximately?
late 70s, not exactly sure. That was the only model of its type that I found. I used to collect just the kits, but found that one the only one of its kind I was able to find.
So we'll try to find an appropriate owner for this evening in another way.
I have a star after the Pledge of Allegiance.
Works for me.
Is it in color?
All right. Well, again, we certainly do appreciate you sharing the evening with us. And we do have refreshments. We'll need a couple of minutes to get them set up. But if you would please like to stay, we would like to have the fellowship. And I know that a number of people who are here would probably like to continue the dialogue that we had begun at the beginning of the evening. And so we'd like to thank you for joining us. If you have any questions about the Battle of Midway, our presenter will still be here. And of course, if you have any questions about Freemasonry, we'll also be happy to answer those. I'd like to thank you very much.